Coe to stand up? Would like Rusty Coe to get in the theater here, please. Ed? Okay. Rusty Coe, raise your hand, please. Howard Martin. Thais Alvarez. Caitlin O'Rourke. Will Bradley, is Will here yet?
No.
No, all right. Drew Seymour.
Not
yet. Okay. Vicki Nelson. Is in the gallery doing something. Matt Gamble is also working in the gallery right now. Michael Sell is in the gallery right now. Sergio is back there. Court Patterson in the gallery. Ladies and gentlemen, the young people here that have the black t-shirts that say Shafty Thundercat, they can tell you the story of that name. But I want to let you know that I am so proud of them. They work so hard, and there is nothing of this evening and what you're going to see in the gallery that is possible without the dedication of our students. Some of them, Nick, alumni, Ed, alumni, Rusty, we can't make go away, so he's Nick's been coming in for 7 days from Port Charlotte, staying with friends to come back and volunteer in the gallery. And it is a monumental sculpture we have done. I am so appreciative of this. And I just want to say that when I had my 52nd birthday this year, you start changing the way you think a little bit, you start thinking about getting older, and you start thinking about what's the future like and everything. And I have such confidence in the future of the world, knowing that they're going to be led by people, and these beautiful musicians who have longer time and bring talents to us, and by people that are members of the Shafty Thundercat. So thank you all so much.
I'm John Davis. I just wanted to start off by introducing Jade Dellinger. He is the curator working with Cesar, and he's a Tampa-based and independent curator. He's worked with artists all over the world. His expertise is in contemporary art. He collaborates primarily with the Contemporary Art Museum at the University of South Florida and the Tampa Museum of Art, and he curated the Things Not Seen Before exhibit last year at the Rauschenberg Gallery here in Fort Myers at Edison State College. That was a visual art exhibit, an interactive installation, serving as a tribute to the legacy of composer, writer, and artist John Cage. And last year, Dellinger also curated the Polyvectral Expansions exhibit here at FGCU. That was also an interactive exhibit on the collaborative work of graphic artist, composer, and video maker Andrew Deutsch. And he's also curated major solo museum exhibitions for many notable artists, including folks like Keith Haring, Lucy Orta, Anne Hamilton, and many, many others. And also curated many collaborative shows, including the Keith Edmeyer and Evel Knievel project at USS Contemporary Art Museum. And this is really just a small bit of what he has done in his career. And despite having had friends in common all over the world, he and Cesar really only met and began like, working professionally together with this project in Puno. And Cesar Cornejo, he is an artist and social and political activist as well. Lives and works in Florida, New York, Peru, and the UK. He earned a degree in architecture from Ricardo Pauling University in Peru, and a master's and a PhD in fine art sculpture from Tokyo National University of Fine Art and Music. And he's also earned many fellowships and prizes for his work, including the Lower Manhattan Cultural Council, Howell Arts Institute, the New York Foundation for the Arts. I'm not going to list them all, I would be here all day. Has had solo exhibitions of the sculpture and architecture work shown in the Puno Museum of Contemporary Art in Lima, also galleries in Tokyo, and also galleries in England, Japan, Austria, Venezuela, and here in the US. And this site-specific installation that is about to be unveiled here at the gallery centers on his current project in Puno, Peru. Really a very ambitious effort that seeks to do much more than showcase art, but really engage the entire community and the global community in showing the people of Puno and really introducing the world to who they are, what their plight is, and really kind of revolutionizing the role of the contemporary art gallery and museum. I think it's a really, really interesting idea. And so I just kind of wanted to start off there. Cesar, if you could just explain a little bit about what this revolutionary concept is, because you're not going to be showcasing art in any kind of formal institution or museum or gallery like we're used to.
Well, thank you very much, John. First of all, I want to thank very much Anika for hosting us, everyone here at FGCU, Jade for all the involvement and support in making this happen. And as Anika had mentioned, all the support that we have from this amazing team of extremely qualified and intense young people that have supported us all in the process. I also have to thank the very impressive, I still have not come down yet from the place that they took us with these amazing performances. I haven't seen or heard actually anything comparable for a very long time. I'm really, really impressed. I will talk about this to everyone for a very long time. Such a special evening. And thanks so much for all the support that you're able to give us along this process as well. I know that everyone here in Fort Myers knows about this project. Thanks to the reflection and Casanella here. The Puno Museum of Contemporary Art is a project that has a very simple proposal. Basically, we're working in Puno, which is it's a town which is at 12,000 feet high. It's part of an area which is considered in Peru in the second poorest area in the country, while at the same time has a very strong presence of tourists because of the Titicaca Lake, which is just Puno actually is the head that shows this lake. So the project is proposing in these poor areas of the city. By the way, the city is 70% of the homes are finished. So what we're proposing is to talk to the owners of the houses and offer them to build, let's say, a room or a space in the house that isn't finished. Complete that space for free with a condition that in exchange they allow us to exhibit art in that space that we have repaired for some time. So when the exhibition is on, people can come into the house, meet the owner of the house, and see the work. And see like that other houses that would have work as well. So therefore the city would become part of the museum. And once the show has come down, they will keep that space for their homes. So they would have a concrete benefit from our presence there. And we would find another house to replace that one as we get back. And therefore the museum would be constantly changed.
So the experience of the person going through this museum is not going to be like, you know, just walking down the hall to the next exhibit. You literally are going through the town. You're not, the way I imagine it now is tourists who are there are probably very isolated from the people who actually call Puno home. And this would actually sort of create more like organic interactions between the people that actually live there and the visitors.
Well, as Cesar was explaining, you know, it really does. I think in this kind of condition and climate, it's about creating a new sort of model for a museum. You know, we think about around the world, other examples like in Bilbao, where you know Frank Gehry has created this fantastic structure architecture, and how it's changed things there in terms of bringing tourists and, but Puno in that sense is a really unique kind of condition. I mean, it's the folkloric center for Peru and in the Andes. And so there is tourism, but like, as you say, you know, the people who live locally and modestly, you know, don't feel the effects of that to any great degree, aside from their participation perhaps in these festivals. So the idea of, instead of creating, you know, a sort of centralized architecture that those would visit to do something that, you know, really is expanded within the community and allows visitors to come and be guided through, and is always changing. I think is most central to the project and what interested me about it, frankly, with and talking to Cesar. So.
And I wanted to ask Cesar, because I know you're from Peru originally, but not from Puno. Well, tell us about your first impressions the first time you were there. And Jay, I'd love to hear your response to that question also.
I went to Puno as a student of architecture, traveling, knowing my country a little bit. And I thought it was one of the ugly cities in Peru. I mean, I heard later from other friends that I was traveling along in Peru that probably it's just second ugliest to Juliet, which is a neighbor of Puno. Because of this broadness of the houses are really unfinished, as a large amount of land. At the same time, as I said, because of the Tigaco Lake, there's a large number of tourists. So it's one of the biggest destinations, not only of tourism, not only in Peru, but in South America. People come to see the Titicaca Lake, which is the highest level of lake in the world. They come to the Uros Islands, want to have a taste of that. But besides those activities, there's nothing really to see or to do. There's one church there, of course, an old church. But people, and that's also interesting because what happens is the tourists would remain only in those hotels or spaces created for them to have that experience, the lake experience the same. And they don't see the city. They don't have anything that would drive them to these areas that they're actually interested in developing.
Cesar was kind enough to, at a stage about 2 years ago, I guess, as he had envisioned the museum, he was at the stage that he was developing relationships locally, and invited both myself and the curator from the Museum of London to come with him to Peru. And for me, it was an extraordinary experience. And really, it was Cesar's passion about the project and dedication to it that so intrigued me. And the conditions there, as have been described, are rather extreme. So our role, myself and Gabriel and Salgado, has really been to be involved as kind of consulting curators. In terms of 20th century contemporary art, a history of artists, creating museums, portable museums, challenging those sorts of questions about how these institutions function. And for me, as a curator, I've been really interested in a lot of those sorts of things. There have been artists like Marcel Duchamp or Robert Fidieu who had a museum in his hat, for example, or a gallery that he would invite artists to make exhibitions in and show people at openings. And Cesar's work, in a way, I think really kind of extends some of those ideas. Obviously, it's very much a social project and very connected with this community that he's very committed to. So in visiting for me, it was an opportunity really to kind of launch the project, and for myself, and I think for Gabriela as well, Cesar has this connection because obviously he's Peruvian too. We really were outsiders in that way. Given the way that we function in terms of, working with international artists, both in Europe and in the United States, our role was really about helping with the program as we move forward, beginning with artists and all of that. But in that sense, I think there's so much about this region, this place, its history that is so unique that as we've begun to really speak with artists and begun to invite them to participate in projects that, and some have already been realized, although no building has really begun, they've each come to it with very specific interests. There's a New York artist whose work is very much sort of tied to doing things that have to do with, an interest in botany. And there are, because of the conditions in Puno, there are really unique features. The same with the lake. There are extraordinary creatures and things that you wouldn't find anywhere in the world. So, in to date have been engaged. And what we're attempting to do here, and Cesar can speak to that too, is very different in the sense that it is Cesar's sort of artistic interpretation, representation. It's a kind of poetic approach to beginning to be able to have a conversation about the conditions there without being didactic in terms of the gallery. So,
and also, thank you. And also, I'd like to add to a few follow-up. Also, my answer was, thank you. Yeah, it was. When I first attended, as I said, I was impressed by the idea into the city. But when I went through all this experience of art, let's say, that journey from architecture to art to place, when I thought about the idea of making this museum, which actually came up in a conversation last time with an artist in Taiwan, and I thought, I'm going to make a museum. We're talking about ideas. And I thought, I'm going to make a museum about houses, in houses, and in Puno. It was, to me, the only place where a project like this would be worthwhile. Not because of the likelihood of having a museum there, but exactly because of the opposite reason. It's probably the less likely place in Peru where actually you could find a museum existing because of the altitude, because of the poorness, because of the hostility. When I told friends in Peru that I was going to develop this project in Puno, they told me also, why do you choose Puno? It's the place where the people are less welcome. And I haven't found a place particularly in my experience that still could be explained because of these conditions of that, and as well because of the history of oppression and abuse that a large number of the population from the Andes have been victims of along the century. So it's a very delicate terrain to step into. I mean, as Jade mentioned, we're going there with her. I mean, he is not from Peru, I'm from Peru, I'm still considered a foreigner when I go there. And so I have to be very, very careful. Although I have, of course, as everyone in Peru, Peruvian blood. My great grandmother was from Guanaco. I think you mentioned one of your players from Guanaco. Yeah, my great grandmother was from Guanaco, and I have that connection. So I still have a hard time trying to keep that relationship, and that we have been able to successfully find some people there that we couldn't have a good relation with trust, which I think is the key in which all this will lie in the future.
Well, and I understand one of the first connections you made with residents there was something of a happy accident. It was actually a taxi driver who you were with.
Yeah.
And you maintained a relationship with him.
Absolutely, yeah. He has been certainly an important person for us. He was an accident, yes. And I think that, as they say, accidents don't exist with this old divine intervention. This person drove me to a place called Ilave, which is a town which is an hour and a half from Puno, which is a place where a sad incident happened some years before my trip. And I thought, because of all these things I've heard about Puno, I thought if I wanted to work in this area, I really needed to go to a place where there was a history of these violence, I'd say. What had happened in this place a few years before I went there was that their mayor had been stoned to death by the population. He took him out from his office and they stoned him. And so I had somehow a journalist spirit somewhere in myself. So I really felt I need to go there and meet the people, and interview the people, ask them about that, and get to understand them a little bit more. Fortunately, things went well, and the taxi driver that drove me there, on the way back, I explained to him what I was doing in Puno. I was looking for a house where I could do some work for free, and explained him the other project. He immediately got it, and he said, well, I have a room in my house, which actually needs some paint and some sanding, and so we drove, instead of taking me back to my hotel, we drove to his house. He said, let me ask my wife, of course, you want to have a glass of wine. So he went quickly to ask his wife, and then he came back and said, yeah, let's do it. So the next thing we did is that we went to buy paint to the store, artist shop, and he shows us all the colors. I started like, doing the sanding myself and painting a little bit, but then after I hired subcontracted his nephew to live with him. So in a way I gave employment in a very small, significant manner, still a very small scale. So that's one of the essence of the project. Hiring people for creating opportunities. That was a certain pattern. He was in touch with him, yes. And I hope that he eventually could become hopefully the director of the museum, because I think he is a constant, very, very visual character.
Tell me a bit about the role you're seeing the residents play in the maintenance of the museum. In the sense of they're not just going to be having a room in their home displaying artwork, they're actually going to be sort of the ambassadors and the tour guides, I guess.
Yeah, I guess, yeah, that term could apply, but what I really enjoy is, yes, as we're working with Jay, and he mentioned we also work with from London, I think that anything in life, regardless of the museum, anything in life develops from relationships. You know, I think the guys who help us today, this time in the gallery, I'm sure we will cross paths again in the future, and hopefully we will be able to do something in exchange for what they did for us now. And that's how it has worked for me always. I mean, I've been very, very lucky to have been mentored and supported by people who somehow in the way I was able to do something for them on the network day. So there's always this relationship of exchange. That's how we met with Jay, actually. I basically offered him a cookie, yeah? And then we came first, and then we ended up going to Peru. So you don't know how things will turn. But actually, it's important, though, is that there is a relationship somehow. And that's what is key. I think more than the goal is what the relationship is about. So the relationship is itself. So when I think about the interaction between the people, you know, I remember of something when I was living in Peru. I belong to different groups. I once was a senior architecture. I was very interested in music, actually, but underground music. I was playing underground band, which was totally very hard to listen to. And then, and I was also, I practiced martial arts for many years. So I was also in a group of karate. And when I had my very practice, I like to mix different groups and see how the guy from the karate talked to the guy from architecture and the guy from the different underground. And I think that for me, there's a lot of excitement in those combinations, how to meet different people from very different places. And what I see in Puno is an opportunity to create a condition as well, a situation where people who live in this very, you know, remote area of the world, let's say, to meet these persons that come from first world countries, maybe, you know, Japan, China, United States, Europe, you mentioned, they all go there. And from that relation between these two distant realities, how can a relationship, how can an opportunity, how can a new idea develop? And that's not something I will ever know. I'm always been impressed by the potential of the creative potential of the people I find there. And I think we have great examples of that. So, I mean, the people that bring from Peru, I mean, they are incredibly talented. I found that in so many places in Peru. And in everywhere in the world. When I've been working in communities before, in England or in Japan, doesn't matter where you are, the communities you think are less central happen to have a huge potential to develop talent. And it's just an opportunity, it's just a matter of bringing the resources or bringing them there where the resources are. So that is what one of the most important goals of the project is, to give exposure that will allow opportunities to develop from a relationship that they built from just a one day visit to a house where they will probably change a telephone number. I'm not even clear, you know, how we will do it. But that brief conversation that we have will lead to a dramatic change in their history, in both people's history, I think. So that is one of the ways in which I think more important than showing the exhibition or what they're going to get in exchange, what they're going to charge for. For me, it's more the human experience that this situation will start. That is, to me, in a sense, what is most exciting, what the most exciting thing to work.
Yeah, it's interesting that symbiosis between, it's not just bringing folks into Puno, it's also bringing Puno, or introducing Puno to folks from all over the world, and creating those connections that maybe aren't happening the way things are set up now. And you had talked, you know, before about the isolation and the poverty of the town, and I know that a lot of that also has to do with not getting the sort of funding that maybe the more metropolitan cities in the country also receive, just in terms of, you know, building a physical infrastructure. Are you hoping that a project like this, introducing Puno to more people all over the world, might give the city more prominence, even within its own the country's government, that it might grow and improve their quality of life and the people who are living there?
Yeah, I hope so. One of the reasons why also the project started was because in Lima, actually, this institution mentioned that, yes, it's true that there is a lot more money, let's say, in cities of Lima, the capital of Peru. But having said that, one of the main reasons why the project started was because in Lima there had been a project to create a contemporary art museum for over 40 years. And they hadn't finished it, not even now, and because of differences, political differences, interests, etc. And so the idea was, the model of that museum was copied from several countries without having the resources and infrastructure or institutions to carry on that kind of project. And what we wanted to create with the Puno Museum was a model that departed from a reality of South America, of Peru, which is a reality of slums, a reality of, now the economy is doing well, fortunately, but it wasn't like that before. We are talking about that today, how different Peru was in the 80s to what it is today. And yes, we hope to bring resources, but not to create what has been made always, or try to be made always, but to invest the resources in a way that's really meaningful to our reality, that is different to the reality of our country. So that is what our really goal is, to be able to open the eyes of the people who make the decisions in Peru and invite them to see our own reality, that we tend to look out normally to copy the models. But no, we had the decision to interview several Peruvian composers, which is really exciting, because those musicians are not known one another. So we're trying to do the same somehow with the museum, trying to talk more about things that we have there that are unknown.
No, when we did the project with Anne Hamilton, and when we sponsored, that's an editor, we made that something that you'd like to do.
Well, you know, at the onset, I think, of this, there has also been an effort to kind of create a brand for the museum. So Cesar had originally designed a logo and sort of set up a website and all of that. So as we've been thinking, this invitation to make an exhibition at Florida Gulf Coast University, you know, really is a thoughtful step in the process. It's something that, as he is also describing, the kind of global conditions and political conditions, I mean, part of it, he has really taken kind of the long view, because it's been a slow path in terms of building. I mean, some of these projects have begun, and they function in the way as models, but there's been some resistance, I think, from Cesar as well, to take governmental money from, you know, locally, because of issues about corruption or about, you know, the political winds that may shift. It could really do damage having seen and understood well what had happened in Lima with the contemporary art museum. Literally there are walls but no roof on the building that has been 4 years in the making. So I think he's been very cautionary about his approach to this. Exhibitions like this, and as he mentioned, we did as well a project that was a MoCA Puno sponsored exhibition in New York. very high profile artist named Anne Hamilton and Deutsch. The primary component of that exhibition that we showed in New York project, which was this interactive drawing project, was also shown here as part of Andrew Deutsch's exhibition 2 years ago. But when we did it in New York as a solo project, we put a big Puno logo on, and Puno became sort of the sponsor, because we knew it would be about raising the profile in New York, and in a way, our roles, Gabriella and mine, but is about being very sensitive about inviting the most appropriate artists who would be engaged, but that would also raise the profile internationally. So, again, there have been exhibitions that Cesar has done that have been related to Puno that have been much more about, interviews with the people with whom he's had exchanges. This show is a very different kind of exhibition. He might speak more to that as well, his goals and aims, because in essence here, it's been about making a kind of monumental sculpture, which you'll have an opportunity to see, and some of these Catalina pieces, which may not be quickly understood, because they're really done in paper and cast and very fragile and beautiful, but you might talk about it.
Sure, did you want to take a moment to maybe talk about some of the elements of what we're going to see when we walk over next door, or perhaps maybe leave that a mystery till we get over there?
I will try to be very general, not to give too much information.
Okay.
So I'm not attempting to leave. I'm still at least sneaking together. We have worked with Jade along the process from the very beginning on the conception of the show. I mean, in many ways, when I work with him in this project, make me think a lot about music production process, where the producer really works very close to the musician to go to a character product. So I feel, because I when I worked in solo shows before, I have worked mostly on my own, and all consulting, but very much I make the decision, I call the shots. But this time has been a very different experience. I would have probably gone on a totally different path if I had done it myself. But we had very intense exchanges with it, which I really enjoy very much because of the, we have, different perspectives. But at the same time, we have done the same. We are interested in the same, achieving the same goal. So, something I learned by living in different cultures. In Japan, I was, thanks to the support of institutions and grants, I was able to live in Japan, England, and the United States, besides Peru. And in each of these places, something that that helped me most, I think, is to be open to the ideas and be open to what other people think. It might be wrong, that is the person's right. And so I have really take make most of Jay's input in the gallery, even last night. He stayed until what time? 3 a.m. or something, yes. Helping us. By the way, those who are not involved in the process of making show,
they were here for a while.
We were here for a while. We were here to fight to confirm that. But anyway, and that's, I guess, kind of normal sometimes when you're doing a show at this scale, right? But, so for me, it has been really exciting to get into that process, because you have an idea, fixed idea, and then suddenly comes someone and tells you, why not fix that? Alright? And then you think, well, at the end you might be resistant, and then you think, why not? And then you go that way, and then you somehow, after many exchanges, you come to the an image. That's how I work. You don't know the image, you cannot, let's say, describe it, which is what I'm trying to do now, not to describe it, sorry. Just to give you the essence of it. And then once that idea somehow was conceived, everything else was kind of clear. The path was clear. But the work here has been, the concept has been similar to the concept of the museum, where we use what we have. I think
think the main resource we have had in this project has been the people, the community. I was so impressed when I came here first, and I found that they had already started making this huge storm in the wall without, you know, any research. They had no fear. I felt, and I can hear, wow, I mean, they are really talking seriously, that they want to make this big. And I saw these people working there, like, very to the work, very committed to the work. I felt, let's make most of this energy. Because, as I mentioned to several people that I talked to about the process, my experience here so far, when I was working the show, was that I had not felt a sense of community that I felt while they were working, all these people, and everyone was working here. Since I lived in Japan, I felt that sense of community really strong, where people really relied a lot on each other. There was not even need to ask for help. People would just come and support you. Do things like, what the have I done to deserve all that? That's what I thought then, and that's what I thought now. So what have I done to deserve this? I want to go. So I was really excited to receive all that help. And then at the same time, I thought this is a great opportunity for us to get somewhere where otherwise I would not be able to get, and I would not know what or change I would have to do. So I was pretty aware of that all the time. So as Jay described, we have the Calamina ones, which Calamina is a term for curated metal sheets that you find in some people or laws, etc., which are used for roofing, these metal sheets. And in Peru, they are really common. They use them in Puno a lot for roofing. It's a very cheap way of roofing a house. And so I started using them a year ago or so as an element for drawings. I made my own Calaminas out of paper, somehow combining the interest I had in paper from Japan, experience in Japan, and my experience in Puno. And so I combined both realities and the craftsmanship in Puno, which was important. And make this Calamina, which if you don't know, you think they are made, you know, they are plastic. But they are paper, and they have been masterly drawn by, you know, these amazing assistants I had. And I created a photograph of two. And there's you see the landscape, you've probably seen the invitation. And then we have a sculpture. A sculpture that, to me, we can talk for hours about this, but I would just say that the essence, as I said, the connection with Puno was that we wanted to use what we had. And the budget, as I said, the most amazing resource has been the assistance and the help that we had. But of course, there was money, which was not a lot, but it was great to have some money. Because in some places, you don't get that at all. You don't even get money. So we got some money, and we wanted to use it in a wise way. So we thought, we want to make something really large, because this is a very large space. We want to just make justice to the space. So we thought the best way to make an impact in this large space is to use the things that they already have, which were walls, division walls, some thick walls, some boxes that they had. And so that's the thing I thought, that's what we can use as material. And that's what we already stated. That's what we're doing in Puno. We have the houses, we have the slums. That's what we're going to use, the houses. Here, we're going to use the walls. And on top of that, we have created this thing that we'll see when we get there. We must say more about it. That has been basically very much connected to the idea of the museum.
Somehow that ties up.
But there's one other piece that you'll see as well that probably takes a little bit of explanation if you're not aware of his work. But Joaquin Torres Garcia is an artist, early 20th century artist, Uruguayan constructivist, who was very influential in South America and Latin America, and had school, and at some stage, having spent much of his life in Europe and connected with all of the major artists of that period, from Picasso and so on, having had very intimate relationships with all of them, had a certain idea about perspective of those as he returned to Uruguay, and so there's a sort of famous drawing, actually, that in a way gets replicated in the gallery, but it's all about one's perspective, and it's from the perspective of someone who was a well-established artist, again, from Uruguay, who had started an art school that was very much influenced, again, by his time in Europe and coming back and sort of seeing the perspective of the people, his students, artists, colleagues. So there's a wall drawing that people will have a chance to see. It sort of shifts one's perspective about South America, really.
I know what you're talking about there. I don't want to give anything more away, so we'll talk about something else. And one of you had mentioned earlier about how Puno is really considered a folklore center. There is a rich culture of art and their history there. Is that part of why you thought this would be a good fit for this type of project? And B, do you see that reflected in the festivals there, that same kind of work ethic that you were talking about?
To say that, no, I didn't think necessarily about the folklore as being the key reason, or one of the key reasons why Puno would be this venue for this project. But I was aware of folklore, yes, and I was aware of the craftsmanship in this area, but it became as something abstract for a long time. Until 2 years ago, I went to the facility called Virgen de la Candelaria, which is a very large festival that takes place in Puno in around April. And, it was February. And then I was extremely impressed to see the overwhelming effort and magnificence of the events, festivities, the dances, the costumes. I after that, I had to rethink all the idea of the project, how can actually we could, with our very humble presence, bring anything new. They haven't raised so much. That's the biggest question I have. And since then, the principal always was to work with the community in deciding the work, or producing the work, even the architect or the consultant with the community. So there's always an input of the community. It's not us imposing the ideas. But now,
there is also a thriving community of artists there.
There is a community. Yeah, there is a thriving community of artists that are not necessarily showing only in Puno. They are already going abroad, they are showing in the States, some of them, and helping to be supportive of that too. So we are really becoming more and more aware of those forces that take place there. Some major artists in Peruvian art history have come from Puno as well, which we have at the end found a much richer source of resources, let's say, than I had ever expected. When I first decided on the patient, I never imagined the potential of the richness, the huge richness that we would find just in the most simple things. Aymar Abakati is an artist who is one of the main collaborators of our project. He actually is American as well, because his mother is from this country and his father is from Puno. And he studied at Bristol, Rhode Island School of Design. And so he graduated from there, he's undergraduate from there. And now he's in a residency at the Smithsonian Museum. So this guy is really doing a lot already. But he has that very strong link to Puno. So he wants to live in Puno. He's doing projects for the community in Puno. And he, for instance, understands the importance of this kind of project. I mean, more than us, he can feel things or see things from the inside, which is something I cannot, even if I try, because I'm not from there. And he speaks the language as well. So for us, it's extremely important to get those people really at the core of the project, and then see how can actually be better translators to their needs and to their ideas. It's somehow, there's a problem called communication. I mean, even people who speak the same language as that.
Sure.
And what happens in Peru is that people who live in the mountains, not, and that also depending on where you are, they have different philosophy of life, different ways of understanding universes, cosmology, I would say. And so that is something that we always try to grasp a little of. And people like Aymar really helps us a lot to have access to that kind of information. He speaks, let's say, both. He can see the kind of on both sides. So we rely on that kind of character. And at the same time, we rely on those people who are, let's say, those who run the day-to-day activities in Puno that have amazing things to share that are less hidden. Or they keep it for their own families, or to their festivals, to express. So we are trying to grasp on that as well. See, how can we, from the, you know, the anonymity that they live in, how can we actually position them as the center of what this project can be? That's makes up.
And Jade, I wanted to ask you, because I imagine in your work, both your works, there's probably this perception that kind of always fighting, which is that this idea of art and fine art is elitist and sort of bourgeoisie, and here you're bringing it into a community where it's a very different sort of thing. Do you find that in more traditional projects or museum projects that this just completely blows that whole concept out of the water?
I think there are a number of artists who've been, you know, investigating this terrain. Part of the problem that I find often is, particularly in newer projects in the United States and in Europe, you have a certain sort of audience generally. And one of the wonderful things about being here at Florida Gulf Coast University is that we're, you know, within the context of a university, you have students and you have professors, and with a wide variety of expertise. So, but you know, often, more often than not, I guess you feel like you're in these sorts of environments, sort of preaching to the converted. You know, you have very intelligent people who understand that there are social problems around the world, and so in that sense, I think also what Cesar's done, which we'll see, is not about focusing really on, you know, facts and figures. And, I mean, it's about having this kind of conversation, which I very much appreciate. I think given the context, I think he's really thought through, and we've had some intense discussions about in advance of the show about what would be most meaningful within this situation. For me, it's always about that. It's always about, as a curator, engaging the most appropriate artists and putting them in a unique and interesting context for them. So in that sense, I mean, I think there are others who are addressing these sorts of social concerns, but I think that there's a kind of elements about the way that Cesar has approached it, a sort of dedication and certainly a deep awareness of context. So, but it gives us the opportunity as well to really speak to these issues, you know, here.
And if I understand the whole concept correctly, I mean, and as you had mentioned, that's an alarming percentage, something like 70% of buildings and homes are not complete. So this would provide you the residents an opportunity to have an addition onto their home, which would serve as the place to highlight and display the art for a period of time, and then they can use the room for whatever purpose they would like, which means that you are going to have to move on and build another space. So how is this financially sustainable?
Well, and even before maybe Cesar answers that, okay. there's another point that you're bringing up as well that also has to do with the artists that might be invited to come, because there has been some discussion that, and Cesar really thought through this, but you know, museums tend to collect art, and artists who are engaged in that context are, you know, their work is bought and sold, and there's a different sort of economy that's connected with museums and the interest in saving these things somehow. And so he has really thought through this about this idea of having an impermanent collection. And so each of the artists, and this is part of our task as kind of consulting curators in discussion with the local people who will be affected in that way, really engaging artists that are open to the idea that if they send work or if they make work site specifically, it's not likely to come back. And it's and there were examples of that which Cesar can talk about as he also talks about the funding, financing. And I think part of these kinds of efforts, particularly in the United States, Europe, elsewhere, are about addressing these issues and also about finding foundations and or, you know, others outside that might help fund the project and help us to get something built there. So.
That's the large, biggest, I guess, question, the funding that we have at the moment. But we, so far, have been able to do the project that we've done thanks to the support of foundations like the Great Capital Foundation, from which I issued a grant 2 years ago. And then also I have been able to use Same as we have an installation here and the drawing. I also have made sculptures along the way about the project and the sales of those works. I have been able to finance some projects as well there. But to be able to make a major construction work has to be a different scale of funding. And I am, as Jake mentioned before, I've been reluctant of working with the government so far. But we are now trying to devise a system way in which we could, through collaboration with our people, I have located a group of young, same as you here, help me, about to graduate economists in Peru who have interest in construction. working with Shanti Tamas in this area. So I've been talking with them about the possibility of getting their support or their involvement to create for an NGO where we can seek the funds in a fiscalized way, maybe from our government, but in a way that's totally controlled, not allowing them. I know that now corruption is not as a big problem as it used to be in Peru. I know that when friends who have worked in the world and they have experienced first hand. And also, we are also trying to create an alternative economy as well as a museum, alternative museum. We are so as interested, we think about this project not only as a museum project, but we also think it as an economic model. And we therefore want to create alternative businesses, alternative activities that could earn some income to the owners, but also finance the project. So it's in a way, it's very large, it's a multidisciplinary project. So it's very broad, approaches. So I am taking one thing at a time, trying to take one thing at a time, but we are looking forward to create the NGO first, to have a platform to be able to receive some kind of support from different places, but do not rely on that alone. Because that's an old model, but we want to use as a platform to create new models of business. I mean, like this idea of the dinner. Jake had this idea of creating a destination for tourists where they could go to several houses and at the end they could go to a house where they would be offered dinner in the house. And therefore, the meal, and they would be charged for that experience between eating with a
but a very authentic experience.
Absolutely. It's totally different to our normal tour with Albert. It's a great experience, a real life. And so those ways I believe more in than let's say the traditional fundraising strategies.
Like a grant and hoping you'll get it again in 3 years or something.
Yeah, right? Yeah, which is a very difficult. I mean, that somehow started from necessity because when I conceived this idea, it was just when the United States was going through a serious crisis in many years. So most foundations had stopped supporting new projects. And South America maybe had not supported since then. So I was forced to find other ways in which I could finance in this manner. I started thinking about sales all the way. And fortunately, I had a good gathering group that takes care of that. So it's always about changing, depending on the conditions, changing the strategy.
All right, well, gentlemen, we are about out of time, and I don't want to delay the actual exhibition opening any further. So, Cesar Cornejo and Jade Dellinger, thank you so much for your time.
Yeah.